and how visualistic they have. They took a lot of each component came from the first act.
Okay.
You did.
Less than knowledge.
I need to move this over, so.
Whatever you think, yeah.
I just moved tripod. Okay.
Oh, we're gonna get an echo.
Or. Can we, mute this one?
Yeah, but you know, again.
What do you think? To just have FEMA? Or to pick up some of the questions out of there?
Probably just have FEMA. Yeah.
All right.
Or just maybe turn it down real low.
That's a good idea.
Not Steve, but the camera mic.
Yeah, the camera mic.
And that way, if it is, I mean, though it's not, it's for them.
Good point. Just a little ambient.
Yeah.
Something, something, something.
Yeah.
Okay. We'll try. Okay, and we'll get out of y'all's hair. Thank you.
Yeah,
okay. Hey, thank you for bringing it down.
Oh,
sorry. Thank you.
Is it fruit?
Good afternoon, everybody.
Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. so glad you came to stay. Oh, Lord, you came from heaven.
You came from heaven to earth to show the way. From the earth to the cross, my debt to pay. From the cross to the grave,
from the grave to the sky. Lord, I need to marry on high. Everybody say, Lord, I need to marry on high. That's it, Lord, I love. Lord, I
love to sing your praise.
I'm so glad.
So bad in my heart.
I'm so glad you came.
I'm so glad you came to stay.
Come on, listen up one more time. Lord, I
lift your name on high.
That's it, people. Lift our voices to
him. Lord, I love to see your praise.
I'm so glad.
I'm so glad you're in my life.
I'm so glad. Oh, you came from heaven.
You came from heaven to earth to
show the way
from the earth to the cross.
My debt to pay
from the cross to the grave,
from the grave to the sky.
Lord, I lift your name on high. Hey, Steve.
Oh, man.
Hey, how you doing, brother? You all right? Good, man. Good.
What up, man? You good? How you doing, sir? It's slow. It's bad. Yeah. Hey, how you doing? Good, good.
Well, can y'all believe we're already at week 5? And this is my time is just dropping all of it, right? So, we're at week 5. Yeah, 3 more weeks to week 5. And I have been here to wait before. I'm glad to have been able to share some information with you all. I love sitting and studying and learning more about history. And the same, more you know about the history, the better you can hear it from people. So I really love to know history. So this, I thought this was an awesome opportunity to be able to share some of the information that I have and be able to study and learn from you. That said, let's talk about today. So, lesson 5. Today we want to jump back into our outline, our syllabus, and we're going to talk about figures in the Bible. I really wanted to take away this, and a lot of scholars really this, blackness and even when they write in the books, they write, a lot of the blackness, I'm from the African, and we break it all down into the rest of the region. But I think I wanted to. Let me make Let me make all of this, y'all. I messed up on the template. I'm thinking to put the insight question on here so y'all don't have to write them out in the class, right? So I messed around and I erased that off the template and we didn't make the five handouts. So this is really the job deeper so y'all don't have to write them out. But I just want to let y'all know that ahead. All right, cool. So for today, we're going to talk about two points. I'm just thinking about the Bible, I already said that. And the other one is going to be, we want to talk about the Gospel of Mark. Not so much the Gospel of Mark, but we will talk about John Mark himself, who was a very important figure for why we even have this conversation. Okay. So, before we do that, let us make our last. Alright? Everybody repeat after me. I will be respectful, be diligent, be diligent, be flexible, be excited.
Be excited.
Amen. Amen. Here is one more. Liberation of faith. Thank you, Holy Spirit.
Thank you, Holy Spirit.
For helping me. To release all control to you. So that God's perfect will is done in my life.
Today.
In the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Amen.
All right. So, we're done with that. Let's move into this. So, the African presence in the Bible. I believe that the Bible is an accurate source for historical information. I believe that it's an accurate source for geographical information. In the day and time that we live in now, so many people argue against the Bible, right? You have some that argue, why do we need the Bible? We don't necessarily need it. There's so many discrepancies with the Bible. We should just do away with it. Yeah? And I think if you get away with the Bible, you're doing away with the truth. And if a think about it like this. It's kind of like saying, let's do away with the church, right? If your neighborhood, is just infested with crime, and there's a church in the neighborhood, can you imagine what the neighborhood would be like if the church wasn't there? Right? So I think the same when it comes down to the Word of God. We hold it as believers as the primary source for which we draw. Therefore, I say it can and must be used as a primary source for exploring Africa's presence in the ancient world. So, let's talk about some African figures. One of the first persons on your handout that we will talk about is Ham, very key figure to the Bible. Ham was a son of Noah. Did anybody see that movie? The latest movie. I had so many friends that were hollering and screaming at me. They said they wanted to holler and scream at the screen because of all the different issues. And of course, you know, with movies they have to make it entertaining. But who was Noah's son, is considered to be the father of African people because he had four sons. One was named Ethan, one son named Canaan, one son named Bud, and the other son named was Cush. Now, as you all know, Egypt, the lineage of Egypt, would become a great empire, African empire, right? What you may not know is that Cush became a great empire, and Cush actually, it lasted for about 1400 years BC. I think it was somewhere around 1750 BC. And it lasted for, I think they had a 1400 year run with this particular empire. And then, of course, we know Canaan, which became the promised land, right? But these are all descendants of Noah. Descendants of Ham, who is considered to be the father of because Ham was the only dark skinned one. So Ham's name actually means hot or heat. Further translated, his name meant black.
What? He was only one.
Out of all his brothers. That's all. He's the only one.
How is that possible for you to have only one black son? Every other.
I can't imagine that.
That goes without saying. Does it? Is it a possibility that even the other children of Noah could be, you know, black or so? It's just based on what they have written down for us, right?
I'm sorry. Yeah. I just turned it off, please.
Okay.
One more time.
Yeah, my question, I said we, following whatever we have, like, based on what is written down, because I'm still on that school of thought that says that, okay, how come only one of them is black? One of
actually conquered Egypt. Somewhere around, I think it was the 7th century BC. Before Christ. Okay? So,
Cush is very important because Cush is what we know today as modern day and the Ethiopians, who are very important to the Christian lineage that derived, that rose up out of Africa. Okay? So, Cush, one of Ham's sons. Next, you have the Cushite woman that Moshe married. Somebody say Moses. Somebody say Moshe. Moshe. Moshe married an African woman. And the scriptural reference is for me. Some biblical persons and nations have names which designate the adjective black color. We already kind of hinted at that. So Simon the Niger, or Simon the Black. And actually, if you ever, you know what? I should have put a link on there. If you ever come across any of his, there's some material, some actual material on Simon the Black, some great literature that I would suggest you check in. Simon the Black, mentioned in the book of Acts as one of the prophets and teachers at the church in Antioch. Then you have Simon of Cyrene. So you also have some New Testament. Remember I said a little while ago, there's so many more figures in the Bible, so many more scriptures. But I was only able to list a few for the sake of this class, and I've got some biblical reference for you all to go back, and you can look at later if you will. But Simon the Cyrene, is a little city that was right outside of, I believe, the one of the we're going to talk more about Cyrene in a little bit, because Cyrene is a very, very instrumental city in Africa. But Simon Cyrene was a bypass. Minding his business, over his right home. And the Roman soldiers compelled Simon Cyrene to help Jesus. He was, so they're in Jerusalem. He was living, he was living in Jerusalem. He was living in Jerusalem. And he was on his way back, he was on his way from somewhere, but the Bible just says that he was a bypass. So he was on the north of Africa. Libya is pretty much a north in Africa. Remember, so during this time, the Roman Empire has conquered all of that coast. So you have trade routes that take place between Libya, right up into the Mediterranean. As you go and you travel up into Jerusalem, you travel up into Antioch, these are all trade routes. Right? So, I wish that.
Is there any literature or interpretation about how to the Bible, as to why God would have had him there to bear the cross? Any understanding from the word or interpretation as to why this African would have been the man, the person, to bear the cross at this time. I'm asking questions, so I'm always...
But that's a great observation, right? Because if you all remember, we talked about exegesis, right? We talked about exegesis, interpreting scripture, right? And that's what you're going to do, right? You just ask a question of the text. Why would this man be happening to pass by Jesus at the time that he was carrying his cross? That's a prime example of what exegesis is. Critical, get asking critical questions of the text.
Stuff happens then. It's not. But I just...
And what's there?
Maybe Lord was there too.
You ask that question.
I know.
But we can't assume.
I know you have asked it before, but since you keep going around, did you just decide that Jesus was black?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes. Jesus was not black. Okay. Jesus was not black. Jesus was Jewish.
No, there's no Jews, no black Jews back then.
There were black Jews, I'll tell you. I was about to jump to it. But there were. You had Jews. So there were a lot of Jews that had migrated into Africa. And then, of course, the children, when they have children, right? And of course, you have Africa during this time is slavery. The cultures are slavery. You have these centers in the world with people coming from all over the place, right? They're coming all up and down the Mediterranean coast. You have them coming in from the Arabian Peninsula. You have them coming in from Canaan. You have them coming in from Europe. Okay? So you have cultures that are mixing, right? Where is it? And I have established that.
What do you mean with birth?
I'm sorry?
Birth, like, you know, different ones and they having children.
Having children?
Mm-hmm. So just so I'm clear on the question. We've established that Jesus was not African, and that he was Jewish, was not made a conclusion around, should we make a conclusion around his color? You kind of said that's irrelevant to the whole discussion. But he's African, and he's Jewish.
And for those of you viewing online, I'm gonna put this in the Dropbox for you, because I think this is. Turned off too soon. I didn't think that was gonna be. I think this is really good for the conversation.
very slow.
National Geographic did a study. And what they did was they put together an image of what Jesus really is in contrast to the images of Jesus that we have seen, and especially as Westerners, right? The long hair, long black, look like a worm, right? So this image is actually online, for whatever reason.
It's just like,
I know what it
is. It's just, yeah.
Yeah. But, matter of fact, can we hit this question? If y'all don't mind. National Geographic did, no, that's not it. It's not. It's not. It's not. But they put together, this image of what Jesus was doing. And he is not the long blonde hair, blue eyes, smooth face. Look like he's been photoshopped. It is not that Jesus, right? But they're basically saying, if anything, this is really what Jesus would have looked like. And actually, Pastor Kim actually just did this Bible study this past Wednesday,
yeah.
Which was a really great Bible study.
Yeah.
And I meant to have that image into the presentation. But I can get this image to you. So this is to help us further understand.
I have a question. We think for me, there was the Samaria and what? Is that like Max in Jerusalem? And he claimed that he will be there before the European Italian migration.
Yes,
yeah, that was the claim. So I don't know how. That's it. What ancient Africa
look like, right? So it shows you just how interconnected their world was, their cosmos. Okay? Yeah. I think somebody asked me for an image of first century Africa. And actually, this here is representative, very small representation of first century Africa. But this map right here shows you just how interconnected Europe and Asia were to Now this is Paul. The Apostle Paul. He's been arrested. Acts chapter 21. Acts chapter 21. I want to show you something. Okay. For a multitude of people followed after finding a way with him. And as Paul was to be led into the castle, he said unto the chief pastor, "Now speak unto thee." Now, we know Paul is a Jew, right? He's a Jew. Verse 2. I'm at verse 37. As Paul was to be led into the castle, he said unto the chief captain, "May I speak unto thee?" Who said, "Canst thou speak Greek? Art not thou that Egyptian, which before these days made us an uproar, and led us out into the wilderness for 4,000 men that were murdered?" But Paul said, "I am a man which am a Jew of Tarsus, a city in Cilicia, a citizen of no mean city, and I beseech thee, suffer me to speak unto thee. Do y'all find that interesting? That this jail mistaken his mistaken him to be in the jail.
Looking at him. One of the things is even when they went to arrest him,
they couldn't figure out the difference between him or his disciples. And so they were asking, well, who is Jesus? You know, because we all look alike. So that was the whole thing right there when we talk about the reason when we say we're in. You know, we all look alike, so it was like, okay, you could be Jesus, you could be Jesus, you could be Jesus, because they didn't know who Jesus was. They heard Jesus, but they didn't really know him by faith. They, you know, because they kept looking at all these people of color, like, well, which one is Jesus? And this is why I brought this up. Because if we get called into the skin color, it's pretty, we just run down and say, I'm after you, after you. See? Because you just said it, because we all know. Right? And so a man mistaken him to be an Egyptian, he's Jewish. So I wanted to point that out to you. But he wasn't Egyptian, he was a computer. For you on your handout, there's a chart that just gives, that shows the number of occurrences for some of the other figures in the Bible. Okay? Just to give you an idea of the African presence in the Bible. Egypt is mentioned 617 times. Okay? And we can't forget Queen Sheba, right? Now, let me transition to the next thing. Mark's witness to Africa. John Mark was from Cyrene. But here's the deal. John Mark, who is the author of the Gospel of Mark, while he was from Africa, he was Jewish. His parents were Jewish, but they migrated to Africa, to Cyrene. And so he was born in Cyrene, but he was a Jew. Mark is very important to the African origins of Christianity, because one, He had a very wide scope for which he traveled. He traveled from Rome to Antioch to Palestine, to Jerusalem, this guy had a phenomenal travel rewards. He could have racked up some really good points. He probably could have had a couple free trips today if he was traveling. Here's why I highlight that. Because in order for him to do the extensive travel that he did, he had to be versed in a multitude of languages. Right? He's born in Cyrene. His parents end up leaving Cyrene because there was a bunch of wars going on in Cyrene at the time, and there was a bunch of civil disturbances happening. So they migrate, they leave Cyrene, and eventually he ends up in Jerusalem. Well, when Mark enters in Jerusalem, his mother would be handpicked by Jesus to help out with hospitality. Mm-hmm. They became converts, or what you call followers of Jesus. Acts says they were followers of the way. We're talking somewhere around, Mark was born somewhere between 5 A.D. and 15 A.D. After the death of Christ. So he is a first century apostle. Okay? And, again, his mother, who was chosen, handpicked by Jesus, to help out with hospitality, scholars say that he fell in love with Jesus. He fell in love with being a follower of Christ. He fell in love with this teaching that Jesus was teaching. Many scholars say that he went on to write quite extensively. Of course, we have on record that John Mark would become the first of the apostles to record Jesus' ministry, Jesus' life, and his death. After John Mark records Jesus' life and ministry, then you have the other gospels that come later. So you have Matthew, Luke, and then you have John. But Mark is the original recording of Jesus' life. He's remembered and even today in Africa, Mark is remembered as one of the most precious apostles to Africa because Mark, after being in Jerusalem for some time, I believe they actually ended up going to Bethany. After leaving his mother in Bethany, he comes back to Africa. So Mark is the apostle that brings the gospel into Africa. He ends up in, of all places, anybody want to guess it? Don't take it. Alexandria. Because Alexandria was what? Yes. Okay. So check this out. What John does, John Mark comes back to Alexandria, and he starts a catechetical school. Okay? Your
catechism is? Yeah. Right? He starts a catechetical school where you inform and you teach people how to communicate with you. So, this is the same school that many of the other theologians from Africa that we talked about earlier in this class would end up going into. Origen, who became a catechetical teacher. You have Tertullian. You have Dionysius. You have Eusebius, Clement of Alexandria. All of these people ended up in this school at Alexandria, right? But it was John Mark who started this school. Y'all remember the picture I showed you of the library at Alexandria, right? These guys, because Alexandria was had such an extensive library, it was these guys who spent most of their time in those libraries interpreting scripture. And so, know this: we didn't have. Can I see the Bible real quick? We didn't at this time. They didn't have this. But remember, it was scrolls, right? Remember, I showed you scrolls. It was all scrolls, and so they would take time and roll these big scrolls out and interpret what scripture was saying. Whether you're interpreting Isaiah or you're interpreting Jeremiah or 1 Kings, any of them, Psalm, Genesis, Deuteronomy, John is extremely important to African Christianity because he was the apostolic leader who brought the good news into Africa. And he spread it. Mark would go on to raise up disciples. Who would take the gospel and spread it. And as you all will know, Alexandria, because it was a very important learning center of that time, quite a few of the theologians, quite a few of the particular African contributors would come out of this. There is a very deep heritage that we are connected to through the work that people like John Mark contributed to the rise of Christianity in Africa. And the problem is that so many scholars, even to this day, try to disregard. Contrary to fact, but they still try to disregard those contributions. I believe Thomas Owen would say, shame on them. And he said, you know, for far too long, this has gone on. Now, with that said, there are a great number of scholars.
scholars who are now putting together teams who will go and do more archaeological study on these types of contributions so that we can search in order to bring this information to the fore. And so what we do here is to introduce laity to the connection to the heritage, right, that we have as an African. Right? So, let's do this. At your table, I said to you all earlier, I messed around and I deleted the insight questions off of the template, so I'll make sure to put those back on there. But meanwhile, would you just write those questions out for me? I'll certainly apologize. All right, first question. What insight did you gain from today's lesson? Once you answer both of those, once you are at your tables, just take some time and just talk about that with me.
Yeah.
It's important for us to know, because this is the Jew in Africa, born in Africa, that God engineered that to happen. Multiple religions, first living part of my travels in every place.
Yeah. Right.
But they had a lot of time to go with that too. Something individual, like
How does this incite you? How does this insight incite you to share it with somebody? Would anybody care to share that?
Thing that we should keep in mind is that we have to be mindful of the fact that we often place soul or heavy emphasis on the answers. And we should consider the fact that asking the question is just as important. So even if you can't share an answer with someone, you can share a question. And through sharing that question, you all can jointly investigate an issue and discuss. Even in fact, if somebody sees you conversing about a particular question, may draw others in to the conversation. And you can use this class, you can talk about church, or anything else. But sometimes just asking the question is just as or more important than the answer.
I had one of my clients, he did exactly what he was doing. When I first started taking a lot of Bible study classes, and I was talking about the Bible study class, and then when I got to him,
what the words you were telling that man about?
Right.
But then I told him about the the website of the church.
Right.
And now he's been there about like 3 years now.
That's how it happened. Exactly. Exactly.
And you all really have a treasure chest. Some of y'all may not live. Because I gave you all my answers. Mm-hmm. It's on the silver. And we just have to remember those resources. So if you sharing this information now, and maybe you say, I don't necessarily know how to share it, but if you're talking to somebody about it, right, and you say, man, I'm really still just kind of pulling all of this information together myself, but I can provide you the resources if you want to check out some of the books that we use in order to write the book. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Is this helpful?
Yeah.
Yeah.